My guest today is a brilliant singer-songwriter who is also known for his work with Steven Wilson as part of the duo No Man. He has a brand new album coming out this month called Stupid Things That Mean the World. I'd like to welcome Tim Bowness.
Hello.
Hey, Tim. It's Roy.
Hi. Hello.
So you're sick, huh? Hope you okay to talk. Sorry.
Yeah, well, I did an interview with somebody actually in Las Vegas. Weirdly enough, it's for one of the European websites, but he's an Englishman based in Las Vegas. So I just did a Skype with him and said that obviously what he was going to get is something potentially quite delirious. So it's probably going to be a bit like sort of John Anderson's psychedelic dream.
Well, we'll try and buzz through it. So, let's just get going here. The new album has come really quickly after the last one. When you took prior to that, like, I don't know, like 10 years since your other solo album. So what's been sort of the resurgence of writing and recording and all that the last couple of years?
Well, I think the first solo album I never really saw as a solo album. I think I always saw it as a solo album in name, really, because what it was that I was involved in about three or four projects with musicians in it. It was Hugh Hopper, Marcus Reuter, Stephen Bennett, and none of them were coming to anything. So with My Hotel Year, it was a way of collecting songs from half-finished projects, and it had a certain consistency and coherence because I used the same mixer on everything and I had a certain sonic approach. So I think it just about worked as an album and definitely had an identity, but it was never really conceived as an album okay. In itself. Abandoned Dental Dreams started off as a series of demos that I'd written and co-written and given to Stephen Wilson for the basis of a new No Man album. And Stephen, because of his incredibly busy schedule, wasn't able to do it. And so he encouraged me to just develop this as a solo album. And so in effect, I think I always say that in some ways Abandoned Nursery Dreams is my idea of what a No Man album could be. It's starts with me and it ends with me rather than going through the filtering process of No Man or any of the other bands I'm in. So in many ways it was much more of a solo album than My Hotel Year had been. And the same with this, really, in that whereas I always write my lyrics and melodies in terms of the music, I co-write quite a bit, but certainly on the last two albums I've written a lot of the music as well. So, you know, perhaps over half of the music on both of the albums is mine as well as the lyrics and the melody. So I've got a lot more personal commitment in terms of production and writing as well as everything else. And I think that if Abandoned Dental Dreams in some ways was my idea of a No Man album, and was a logical progression from Schoolyard Ghosts, this is something of a logical progression from Abandoned Dancehall Dreams, in that it started out with this idea of where can I take this music further. And so they were very much conceived as albums. And the interesting thing is that, as I say, historically, producing an album a year isn't particularly strange. You know, if you think of a lot of the old progressive bands, you know, I always think of somebody like Ian Anderson of Jethro Tull, and I think he had an album a year from 1968 to 1980. And what's astonishing about that is that each album was very different from the preceding one, and that they were also touring perhaps for 6 to 8 months of a year. So it's not historically that strange that people come up with an album a year.
No, it's more nowadays it's uncommon, but you're right. I mean, even going back to like Genesis in the 70s, their first few albums, I think were a couple or two in the same year or,
absolutely,
you know, something, which was great. If you love that band, that was a lot more fun.
Yeah. You know, and it was an astonishing output, and I say even more astonishing that they would be touring so much and that the albums would change so dramatically. I mean, for me, interestingly enough, what happened is that, Abandoned Dental Dreams I'd finished in December 2013, and so for the 6 months prior to it being released, a lot of time was spent on getting the artwork right, promoting it, perfecting the mixes. So in some ways, the album was already complete. And the first half of 2014, I was moving cross country. So for me, it was one of the longest periods I've had not writing music, not being not being able to actually record things because my home studio was in tatters as I was moving across country. Yeah. And it was in July of last year that I finally set up the home studio again. And it was about 2 or 3 weeks after Abandoned Until Dreams had come out. And it had come out to, you know, some of the most encouraging reviews and responses I'd had. And there was, you know, quite a nice energy surrounding it. And so I think that buoyed by that enthusiasm, I started writing again. So when I started writing for the album, it had been after a period of 7 months of actually doing nothing, which for me was like an eternity. Yeah. And then from about July 2014 to February of this year, I did a lot of writing and also co-writing and going through my archive of unreleased songs. So it's quite a sort of productive period. And I suppose, you know, you could argue that on one level, seeing, you know, where I could take this music, and partly as well because I'd had 7 months of not writing, I'd been building up ideas and building up, you know, probably frustrations and emotions and whatever else find themselves in the music. And I'd say that about 85% of the music on the new album is from the last year. So, you know, because one of the questions that's often been asked is there any overspill from the Abandoned Dance Hall Dream sessions? And there isn't. You know, that 85% of this was freshly written. And then the pieces that weren't were from my archive, and they were significantly rewritten for this because I think that when I started the album project, I had an idea of how I wanted it to sound. And what's interesting is that I started with a very specific idea, and I think that that's what I achieved. But during the process of getting to that, there's a lot of trial and error, a lot of hit and miss. So I wrote more material than was used. I recorded more material than was used. And in some ways, what you always do is you start with a certain notion, which hopefully you end with, but in order to get there, you're whittling down because, you know, for me, album length and album order are as important as writing songs sometimes, because I think strong material can be destroyed if an album is overlong or doesn't flow.
You said there's a progression from the last album to this one, and I think you can hear that, but I'm curious where sort of conceptually and lyrically you see the difference, and you know what makes this album different compared to the last one, maybe more lyrically, I guess.
I think, well, on a musical level, I would like to think that what it does is it's playing at the edges of what the previous album was. So I think in some ways this is more accessible and more experimental. It's more acoustic and more electronic. It's quieter and it's louder. So I think that the extremes have gently been pushed on this compared to the last album. Lyrically, it's difficult for me to say. I think there is, as there was last time, a sort of overriding mood and theme, and obviously, with the title and the title track, I had this idea of, you know, the tiny, trivial things that actually keep us going as human beings. The fact that, you know, quite often we can be attached to ridiculous things that have significant meaning. You know, there's often ways in which we sort of try and ward off fears of mortality. Yeah. Which sounds incredibly serious, of course. Yeah. But, you know, I find it was, you know, my father is an interesting case in point, that, you know, this is a guy who's now in his late 70s and certainly not in the best of health. But, you know, I often find that he will be enthusiastically discussing his book collection or his stamp collection or a particular film he's seen, and you can see that it's these things that on one level give his life meaning, on another level they're trying to, you know, they're an escape from the more serious issues that, you know, that are ongoing in
his
life. Yeah,
I think that's with everybody. That's why it's such a great album title and so relatable, you know, which is cool.
Well, I mean, on that, I mean, one of the saddest stories relating to sort of a musical obsession was one of my best friends. His sister had been engaged to be married, and the guy was 24. This is, you know, quite a time ago. And a couple of weeks before the marriage, he'd felt a certain pain, went to the doctors, and found out he had terminal cancer. And was actually dead within about a week and a half, which was utterly bizarre. But my friend, I always remember his story, was that he went to see him and he'd bought him Peter Gabriel's So. And rather than actually concentrating on the fact that he was dying of cancer and probably wouldn't be here within a week's time, he was talking about how much the songs meant to him and how much, you know, this was important in his life. And I always kind of find that as an example. Of course, you know, I'm not saying that the music is stupid in any way, but of course, it appears trivial in the face of imminent death.
that's, I'm sorry to hear that about that guy. That's awful. Mm. I wanted to ask you about the first track also, the Great Electric Teenage Dream, which has just a really cool line in it that I like, where you say, your great electric teenage dream, once a record, now an unpaid stream. So that's really powerful. And is the song about sort of the digital age and how you, when you're younger, you want to be a successful musician, but good luck with that?
Well, it's partly, with that song, it's part of a series of songs I've been writing that go under the name of Third Monster on the Left. And what it's about is people making music in the digital age, that because obviously music has always changed as technology has changed and as the formats of delivering music have changed. So, you know, when the LP came in, the likes of Frank Sinatra created the concept album. When the CD came in, people used that space in certain ways and certain sounds were preferred. So I think that, you know, technology and sound has always influenced the way in which music has been made. And I think that in the 21st century, of course, where music, generally speaking, has less value to people, certainly less monetary value. How does that impact on the musicians? And so I'd written a series of songs that were about people either in the music industry or on the fringes of the music industry. And I sort of saw them as maybe being, you know, that maybe even a generation older than I am. People are sort of in their 60s and 70s who are still plying their trade to an aging audience. You know, it's like, what is it like when you're sort of 69 producing your greatest hits to an aging audience with your music being given for free? You know, perhaps it's that bizarre thing where on one level you're still being treated perhaps like a god by your devoted audience, whereas on another level, you know, your income suffered, your lifestyles suffered, you maybe are going through the motions of regurgitating your hits just to make a living. And I suppose I was sort of interested in how that affects the psyche of a musician and the quality of the work they would make. Because one of the things I've believed is that obviously, any musician wants to reach people. Money is not the be-all and end-all. I think that most musicians I know and have worked with, they make music because they want to touch people, they want to reach people. But there's also probably a truth to the fact that when music was a huge money-making concern in the 60s, 70s, 80s, it possibly did produce more innovators, because sometimes where there's money, that's where the great minds of a generation gravitate. Right. So, you know, you could argue that from the 90s onwards, where computer games were where the money is, that a lot of great minds were attracted to it and worked within the context of that. So, you know, I think it was it's a complex issue, but yes, it was partly imagining a character who's had some success in another decade, reflecting on their career, reflecting on where they are. Sorry, it's a very convoluted and long
answer. Yeah, I know. I love approaching this subject matter, actually, and asking guys like yourself, you know, what do you think about, you know, the whole Apple Music and the streaming and, you know, making it now as an artist is a challenge.
I think it's an incredible challenge. I think that, you know, I'm very fortunate that I actually got into music at a time where it was more valued. And there is also, you know, still a generation of music lovers who see that value, of which I'm a part. You know, I still consume and buy music on a very, very regular basis. And the interesting thing for me is that I still love the physical product, that I love engaging with the artwork as well as the music. You know, there's a kind of totality and there's a romance to it that I don't think you get with a download or a stream. Even though I probably listen to my music and have done for a decade or more via iPod or via computer, I still buy the physical product. I still connect with the physical product. And, you know, this could be a generational thing. But, yeah, I think it would be incredibly difficult for younger musicians to come up and establish themselves with an audience. And although I think on one level things like Apple Music and Spotify are great in the sense that if you want to use them to discover music, they're fantastic tools. You know, I tend to use YouTube for much the same thing as well. You know, for me, I tend to use these services as a means of finding out whether I want to buy the physical product.
Right.
But, you know, obviously for a lot of people, it's the end in itself. And I guess it does mean, you know, ultimately, you know, maybe it's 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, but ultimately it might mean that there will be no full-time musicians, or there will be very few full-time musicians. And of course, what's interesting is that even in the glory days of record contracts and enormous vinyl and CD sales, that perhaps only, you know, 0.1% of musicians ever made a living out of music. You know, maybe now it's going to be 0.1% of the 0.1% that make a living in the future. And I'm always reminded of a story that Stephen Bennett tells me. Of course, it could all be in his imagination, but he says that he read a science fiction story from about 10, 15 years ago where art has become available for free on the ether. And as a result, nobody produces anything. So all music, all literature, all film, it's available for nothing. And it's, on one level, constantly available to stream. It's valueless. And it produces an era of apathy, you know, which I really hope, you know, won't be the case, you know. There are sort of things to ponder on, certainly.
Yeah. The other track that was just released as a lyric video, which is really great, is Sing to Me, which is the second track on the album, which comes from an older demo. So what's the story behind that one, and how did you come across that demo to decide to do it?
Well, Stephen sent me about three or four No Man demos. This would have been in October 2014. He sent me three or four demos that I'd completely forgotten about, because we've been putting together a No Man Lost Songs CD, and so he was sending me other pieces for consideration. And a couple of them were very early pieces, including the first thing we ever did together. When we first met, Stephen and I, it was, I think it was June 1987, believe it or not. You know, Stephen was a teenager and I was just out of my teens. And we sat around talking, and then within an hour, we wrote two pieces together, really different pieces. One was this incredibly vicious noisy piece, and another was this very stately, graceful, atmospheric epic. And part of these pieces, essentially, was in fact the first piece we'd ever written together, which was called Screaming Head Eternal, which was, if nothing else, hilarious. And in these demos was a track called Best Boy Electric. And what it consisted of was a minute of this very, very pretty piano line and vocal, which was mostly improvised lyrics. And then this absolutely crazed coda in 7/8, where it seems to me like Stephen is actually sitting on the organ and I'm making death metal growls, you know, it's kind of, and bizarrely enough, we did try that with Sing To Me, but we decided, I think, fairly sensibly that it didn't work. But yeah, I just thought the melody and the piano chord sequence was really... very nice. I didn't know why we'd not developed it. I'd completely forgotten about it. And so I took that and used it as the basis for Sing To Me. And the only thing that remains from the No Man demo, other than the piano chord sequence, is the line Sing To Me. That's it. Wow. Otherwise it's completely rewritten lyrics, a couple of new musical sections. So even that, in a way, although it sort of dates from 1994, really most of it dates from late 2014, early 2015, and I think that was one of the things I liked about it, that it sort of, you know, had the air of classic early No Man while also, you know, being quite comfortably tied into what I'm doing with my solo music. So yes, it was very much rewritten in the sense that I'd only taken the sort of the minute song fragment and developed the 6 minute Sing To Me out of it. And what it was that when Stephen sent it to me, you know, not only was I surprised that we'd not done anything with it, I thought that's exactly what I want for the Stupid Things That Mean the World album. It was just ideal timing. It was one of those sort of eureka moments that I'd been sort of scrabbling around through the archive and writing new material, and that came at just the right time.
Yeah, that's a song that really has stuck with me initially in listening to the album. I just love it. Did you send him the final version kind of in the middle of the process there? And did he have anything to say about it?
Well, I sent him the album when it was finished. And yeah, he didn't necessarily talk about that song, but was really positive about the album. I mean, we're in regular contact still. And, you know, we often discuss anything from, you know, what No Man Archive project we'll be working on to what music we're listening to the things we're personally doing musically. And yeah, he was very encouraging. I sent him some of the early mixes of the album when it was finished, and he gave some, you know, really decent advice. And so, yeah, I'd say he's been... positive, and that's good, because, you know, he tends to be positive when he means it rather than for the sake of it.
Well, listen, man, I love the album. I'm a big fan of what you do and that, this whole kind of style of music. So thank you for taking a few minutes and talking, and I want to wish you the best with the album, and I hope we speak again soon.
Adieu. All right, see you.
Bye. We're going to close with a track off of the new Tim Bowness album, Stupid Things That Mean the World. This is the track Sing To Me. For more information and upcoming interviews, please check theprogreport.com. Follow us on Facebook, at The Prog Report on Twitter, and subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. Thanks.
The bridge over the traffic conversations after dark endless walks roads to nowhere, moonlit faces in closed parks. The way she looked to you, remembered what this could make you to recall. defenses and the temper didn't bother you at all. Sing to me, she said. Sing to me, she said. You were dreamers on the sidelines. Sing to me, she said. Sing to me, she said. Seeking magic in somebody else's world. What this could make you do, recall.